to welcome you to week three of the Unqualified series, and I think you're going to enjoy this experience. It'll be a little different because I had the opportunity this week to visit one of the e-groups in our church, the group of none other than Mike and Courtney Bursich. I had to practice pronouncing their last name several times, but these are incredible leaders at our Lake Norman campus, and their e-group is highly ranked as one of the holiest, most righteous, most amazing, friendly, stylish, best-looking, and spiritual groups in the whole church. Well, I got to spend a little time with them unpacking the message of Unqualified. They got to ask me questions. I got to ask them some questions, and you'll see some of that throughout the experience. Also, we're going to take a look at a few of the sermons that inspired some of the chapters in the book Unqualified, and I think you'll have a good time with that as well. And we're going to worship in response. It's going to be amazing. But right now, let's head out to Lake Norman, North Carolina, and see Mike and Courtney Bursich. You're going to love this group. You guys have been reading Unqualified as a group. I know you've all read it two or three times.
Yeah, sure. Sure.
Amen. I thought we would start out with a little quiz on Unqualified to see how well you've done your reading.
Yes, and I have it right here. Who is Max? You dedicated this book to Max, and you said you are the better
okay,
man.
Okay, so he obviously hasn't done his reading because I tell that in the first chapter. But we're not gonna
What I was hoping was, you'd give us the background on Max. Chris.
Next. Being a young married couple, where my feeling of unqualified comes from, when I know I got areas that I'm broken in. I got stuff that's just as jacked up, but then I'm still supposed to, like, lead my wife, deal with the financial stuff, take care of whatever issues we got going on. And there's sometimes where I'm like, I ain't got an answer for this one. You know, but as a young man, like, you start to realize, like, when you gain this type of responsibility, it's not just you anymore, but you're also, you still got issues. Right. So sometimes I almost feel like, unconsciously, you feel like you should have it all together before you should be able to lead this marriage. Right. So I always struggle with that. Like, well, what do I do? Because she knows. She's with me every day. So for me, it's like, well, how am I supposed to lead her when I got flaws?
To me, leadership is progress, not perfection. But you have a picture of a leader in your mind, and it's this 6'9" Greek god with the pecs of the rock. This guy speaks in perfect parables. You know, this guy gets up at 4:30. He makes bacon and eggs in the shape of Bible verses for his children. If only there were any Bible character to reflect that. What we see when we get into the scriptures is people who, wait a minute, that's the guy you chose? That's the guy you chose? Not only was Moses a murderer, but he ended up striking the rock and didn't get to enter the promised land. He died on the edge of it. But now we preach about Moses, yeah, the mighty man of God. And that's the leader you want to be like Moses. Really? That's our guy? I think our definition of leadership sometimes and our definition of being a good husband and being a good dad, it's impossible. And the enemy likes it that way. One place the Bible calls Satan the accuser of the brethren. No matter how much I give it my all, if I take Graham to practice, I need to spend some time with Abby. Yeah. If I spend some time with Abby, I need to get some quality time with Holly. If I spent the time with Holly, but you know you got that deadline hanging over you for that project. And there's always accusation, and sometimes you just have to silence all that and go to bed knowing I did what I could today, and God can make up the difference. But if you expect straight A's across every category in your life every day, you are setting yourself up for a sense of internal failure for the rest of your life. You cannot expect to kill it everywhere every day. So I live by a little motto, you don't win everywhere at once. You don't win everywhere at once. So you have to diversify your effort and give up on this idea that every day, that in every area, you're going to turn in a perfect score, because it's not going to happen. And once you set yourself free, you realize that you are projecting onto her an expectation that's not even hers. She doesn't even expect you to have all the answers. That's not even her expectation, and it's not even her ideal. What she wants is for the two to become one. So I would change my scorecard on that one. Don't judge yourself based on an imaginary, fictitious version of a leader or a husband that doesn't exist, and kill yourself and your self-esteem in the process. To me, the essence of Chris's question has to do with identity. And how do I deal with my deficiencies honestly, but not allow my deficiencies to become my identity? I remember teaching in our church for the first time a couple years ago about the third word, and I wrote about it in the book. The main idea is that God wants to give us the gift of identity, his sufficiency, his qualifications. And I think when you see this, how God wants to give you his name in your situation, in your weakness, and in your need, it's going to change your life forever. You ready, Doug?
Ready.
Show them the clip.
I read about how God used Moses anyway. How Moses led the people across the Red Sea, doubts and all, dysfunctions and all, deficiencies and all. I read about how God called him up on a mountain and gave him 10 commandments. I read one of those commandments in Exodus chapter 20, verse 7, and I've seen it all my life, but I never saw it quite like this. Because I was reading about how God's name is I Am. And how he said, this will be my name for all generations, I Am. And then I read about in Exodus 20, verse 7, that one of the commands that God gave Moses to give the children of Israel goes like this. He says, you shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. For the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Growing up, I always thought that commandment had a very specific and limited application. Don't say, oh my God, or don't say, dear Lord, or don't say Jesus Christ like a swear word. And I get that, and I'm with that, and we got to honor how we use God's name. But this isn't just a command about how you use God's name. It's a command about how you take his name. Now, let me give you an analogy about taking somebody's name that might be more familiar to us. It might translate what the Hebrews would have seen when they saw this command. See, in times past, there was a girl named Holly Boynton. But on the greatest day of her life, she became a Furtick. What happened? They didn't just change her driver's license. They didn't just change her passport. She didn't just get downgraded from one of the worst last names you can have, Boynton, to probably the worst name, Furtick. Hard to go down from Boynton, but somehow you did it. But when she took my name, she became one with me. She became part of me. What we do together. What we have together. We didn't sign a prenup. You don't need a prenup for $35 in your savings account. We didn't need one. We're just in this together. She took my name. Let me tell you what happened to you on the greatest day of your life when you became a Christian, when you called on the name of Jesus, when you asked him to come in and turn your life around. You took his name. You became one with him. What he has, you have. There ain't no prenup. Whatever he's got, you've got. You became a participant in the divine nature. Hold on a second. And so God says, when you say, I am, and you start filling in the blanks with stuff that contradicts what I've said about you, you are taking my name in vain. Because you're one with me. Because we're in relationship together. So don't take my name in vain. When you walk around in insecurity and you say stuff like, I'm so stupid. I'm such an idiot. I'm such a loser. I'm such a terrible mom. God says, I'm not any of those things. And if I'm in you, you're not either. What I am, you are. Stop taking my name in vain. So, you say, but God, I'm so dysfunctional. And God says, yeah, but I am so gracious. You say, yeah, but God, I'm so deficient. And God says, but I am so sufficient. My grace is sufficient for you, for you, for you. Touch somebody, say for you, for you. God, I'm so doubtful. And God says, I am so faithful. I am. Whatever you're not, whatever you need, whatever you didn't get from your parents, I am. Whatever you're not getting from somebody else, let me be it to you. I am. It's our confession. In Him, I am. In Him, I am.
Now, the more you declare that, he who was and is to come is the one who lives in me, the more you begin to shape your identity, not by what you see in you, but by what God says about you, is going to create a confidence, a holy confidence. Yet one of the things that JC wanted to know from me was, how do I develop that confidence without letting it become arrogance? Check this out.
To have success at a high level, how do you handle that? Because it can take you away. Mm-hmm. It can really take you away, but how do you stay
grounded? Humble?
Yeah, how you stay grounded? Because I fell away from it for a little bit.
I got you.
Yeah.
The place where I struggle the most is discouragement, not the pride of thinking I've arrived. And I remember when our church first started growing, people would say, hey, I'm praying God to keep you humble. And I appreciate that. I need that. God knows I need that. But it was almost like they assumed, well, if the numbers are getting bigger, you must be getting a big head. What they didn't realize is the bigger the church got, the stupider I felt. Because I don't know how to do this. I've never done this before. For me, as God has given me more influence, it's created more dependence. Because my biggest pride in the church was when we didn't have anybody. Because I knew exactly what I was going to do when they came. So I had all these plans for ministry, and then people got involved. You know? How dare the people come in and mess up my ministry plans? I knew exactly how it was going to be. Well, now I get up every day with the responsibility, since that people are counting on me, and that's heavier. So the responsibility created a weight that kept me on my knees. So I wanted to say back to those people, I appreciate your prayers for my humility. But would you mind praying for my confidence too?
Right. Wow.
Because to get up and to know that you're preaching a sermon that's going to go out to this many people and be accountable to God and lead people to a place you've never been,
right,
and try to pioneer things and deal with critics and all of it. Mm-hmm. Could you pray for my confidence too? Because I could use a good dose of that right now.
Right. Yeah.
People probably don't think that too, huh? Mm-hmm. You know, they just think that, you know, confident guy gets up there, kills it every week.
Is that what they think?
Absolutely.
Let's dispel that myth right now. There is a measure of confidence. I do know that God has called me. I also have moments, though, where I open my Bible on Friday and say, God, what do you want? Do you want me to sacrifice one of my children to you? I'll kill him right now. Just give me a sermon. I got to have something to say. People are showing up. I can't put this off. I have those moments of desperation. I have those moments of wondering, what if the whole thing falls apart? And I think it's important that I share as your pastor that I have those moments, because you have them too.
Right. Right.
I was meeting with a group of men the other day before I went out to preach, and I made a statement that shut the whole room down. Everybody's heads dropped when I said it, and they all laughed. I said, secretly, all of us in here feel like we're faking everybody out, and we're wondering when is going to be the day when everybody realizes that we have no idea what we're doing as men and leaders. And all the men said, amen.
Amen.
And sometimes our overconfidence is actually overcompensation. The way that we're coming across is that we're really that tough, but really on the inside, we're thinking, wonder if she knows I don't know how to change a tire. Wonder if she'll still respect me if she finds out I don't. But really, at the core of it all is an insecurity. What if they really knew how clueless I am?
That's good.
Wow. Your brokenness is how you connect with others. I honestly think that's one of the greatest lessons that I learned, is that vulnerability creates connection. God gave us these two words to connect with him. I am. Remember, he said it to Moses. But there are two words that God gave us to connect with others that I think are pretty powerful too. Check this out. See, for so long, the church has been known for two words. You should. And usually we follow it with not. We'll even get King James about it sometimes. Thou shalt. You remember when we were talking about my book, Lisa, and you were telling me about in the first chapter of your book, you can't start just showing everybody all the information that you have and all the things you know. That's great. That can be in the book. But the thing that needs to happen when they first start reading the book is not you should. The first thing they say when they read your book, they need to hear you saying to them, that reader that's reading that book, they need to hear you saying, me too.
And they need to read your struggle and say, me too. The two most powerful words that you will use to minister to somebody are not, you should. Because half the time they already know what they should be doing. Can I be real? They already know what they should be doing. What they really need most of the time is just for somebody to say, me too. There it is. That's the two most powerful words that you can use when somebody is hurting. You can get into the advice, but you got to start like Paul did in Philippians chapter 1 and say, me too. Just like you're chained emotionally, I'm chained physically. Our situation isn't the same, but our struggle is. It must have shocked them that the great apostle Paul would get down on their level and relate to their struggle. This is the guy who wrote most of the New Testament. And he's identifying with these nameless people at the church of Philippi saying, hey, we're all in this together. Me too. Me too. You cry sometimes. Me too. You know what the hardest thing about preaching is for me? Is staying up here on this stage. Do you ever notice how I come out to the edge when I preach? It's nerve-wracking for Holly. She's told me before, she said, you know, you just make me so nervous. And it's just a matter of time. One day I am going to come falling off, and hopefully the people in the front row will love me. But in my heart of hearts, I don't, and I have to be up here because it's good for the lights and the campuses and all that. But where I really want to be, and I used to do this in the early days of the church back at the Providence High School. What's up, Providence? I used to get down on that floor, and when I was preaching and it wouldn't feel like it was connecting, I'd come down off that stage because I like to look people in the eye, make them uncomfortable, you know, violate their personal space, and just get down here and say, me too. Me too. I think that's part of what a good sermon is just somebody saying, me too. Me too. You mean you yelled at your kids this week? Me too. You yelled at them this morning? Me too. You yelled at them right before you came to preach? Me too. That's what I want to say. That's what I want to say. You mean you wore pink pants to church? What? I don't get to put that on my thing, but... You mean you have doubts sometimes about some of the stuff you read in the Bible and you can't reconcile and it doesn't make sense and you just have to trust God? Well, I trust this as your word, but I don't understand it. Me too. I don't understand everything in the Bible. Remember the first time we had lunch and you said, the favorite thing I told you was that I lose my temper. You said, that's immediately your favorite thing. It wasn't something deep I said. It was just me saying, me too. Me too. Me too. I'm saying, you tried to pray this week and you fell asleep. Me too. You ate a whole bag of Doritos by yourself this week at 11:30 p.m. Me too. Me too. You wanted to cuss somebody out in traffic this week. Me too. But I remember I had a sticker on my car, so I couldn't, but I wanted to. Me too. Me too. Touch everybody you can reach and say, me too. Me too. Me too. You're not crazy. Me too. You're not the only one. Me too. You're not in this by yourself. Me too. Me too. Me too. Me too. I hurt. Me too. I struggle. Me too. Me too. If Paul struggled, you'll struggle. If Paul suffered, you'll... Me too, man. Me too, sweetheart. Me too, bro. Me. I want this to be a me too church. Me too. Me too. Me too. And I'm so glad that Paul didn't get his ministry example from the Pharisees. Because they stood up on the stage and preached down to people about what the people weren't doing right. But Paul didn't take his ministry cues from the Pharisees. Paul learned how to minister by watching Jesus. and see what Jesus did that the Pharisees wouldn't do is he got down from the main stage of heaven and he came to earth in the form of a little baby. And he started to step down the staircase of heaven by being born to a virgin in Bethlehem. And he walked on the earth and he suffered like you suffer. And he struggled like you struggle. And he was tempted like you were tempted. And he came down where you are so you can know when you struggle, you've got a God who doesn't stand on a stage, but steps into your situation and says, me too. Me too. Me too. High five five people. Tell them, me too. Me too.
Watching that brings back a lot of memories for me. Number one, I remember the fear in Jimmy's eyes. You can see it right there. I love Jimmy. And secondly, I remember being so jet lagged. We had just come back from Australia and I was preaching delirious. And that's probably why I'm climbing across seats. But I heard so many people tell me that that sermon helped them. And the interesting thing about it was so simple. Just saying that our business as Christians is acceptance, accepting others. And really that's what the message of Unqualified is about. Accepting God's acceptance of you, accepting yourself just as you are, and accepting God's process of change. And as that process happens, it's so important that you don't just share your struggles, but also share your victories. We overcome by our testimony. One of my favorite parts of visiting the group was asking them to share with me some of their stories, just a short version of what God had done in their life through the church. It really lifted me to hear what they had to say. I want you to see it too.
I'd say for Meredith and myself, so we both gave our lives to Christ through Elevation 2010. So thank you for starting the church. And wow. You know, it's amazing. Changed the trajectory of our lives and our kids' lives forever. Mm-hmm. You know, it's changed how we approach everything from perspective to how we parent to our careers, the people that we surround ourselves with.
For me, hands down, has been the transformation in my husband.
Yeah.
That's right.
Hey. I'm changing.
If you are, I can see it.
I'm changing. I'm
in
changing.
This very moment.
I'm changing.
For someone who was so closed off and so self-centered, to become someone who wants to be a part of the knit of the community, to see God work through you to bless me, for him to be the man that he wants to be in our home, has changed my life.
About a year and a half ago, we just wanted to go on vacation. We drove to Florida and we wanted to stop up here. And I had followed you online, and it was one of those where you were like my online pastor for a little bit, and you were preaching in the Death to Selfie series. You were talking about Leia, and I just remember the only thing I remember was like, Leia.
It was Leia.
But what that did for us is we left the church, and we went out to dinner. All we did was talk about the sermon. Mm-hmm. And I can't remember the last time all we did was talk about what we heard and talk about how that was going to affect us that week and what we were going to change about our lives. Mm-hmm. Just because we were so busy doing everything else, we just never had that conversation in our marriage.
For us, I'll never, ever forget this moment as long as I live. Our marriage was completely broken. I had met with a divorce lawyer, and my sister came up to stay with me, and she lived in Charlotte, and she had known about you, and she's like, let's just watch a sermon. So we were online, and we went and flipped through, and we pulled up Don't Stop on 6.
See, the reason you can't stop is because you might be on 6 and not even know it. You might be so close. Wouldn't it be a shame for you to quit when you're this close? Wouldn't it be a shame for you to walk away when you've come this far? Wouldn't it be horrible for you to bail out when you're just this close to victory?
And I was like, there's this crazy guy on my TV stomping around telling me don't stop on 6. And I sit back and I go, in 1 week, I'll be married for 7 years. And it was just God in that moment telling me, like, don't give up on your husband. Like, yeah. I got him. I'm going to fix him, and I'm going to give you the marriage that I always want. And it was because I saw that I stayed. It was in that moment God talked to me and just said, just let me get you through this, and I'll give you everything you've ever wanted. And he really has.
That's awesome.
Hope you've enjoyed the journey today. I know for me, it was a real blessing to get to hear how God is using the message of Unqualified in the lives of real people. Hey, by the way, if you want to take a group through Unqualified, make sure to visit IamUnqualified.com. Maybe you lead a group in your church. Maybe you want to do it just with some friends. We would love to help resource you for that. IamUnqualified.com. Remember, spread the message about the book. Use the hashtag. Make sure if you haven't gotten your copy, do it. We want this message to bless you. God does big things through broken people. Join the club, Club Unqualified. God bless you.